This is sort of a brief tutorial on how to make heat haze, sort of a heat haze effect, and I'm going to show how to do it with Monogame and to do it with an effects shader, which is basically like an HLSL shader, but the same principles apply with GLSL. This tutorial, I'm just going to briefly go over the principles and the shader itself. I'm not going to go into too much detail on anything else that's going on here, and I'm kind of assuming that you have some background in how to use shaders. At least a little bit of background will be helpful, and you should already be familiar with Monogame in order to follow along easily. I'll just quickly go over what you'll need first. Here we got our standard setup. The font you won't need, but this effect, you can call it whatever you want. We've got effects hot. And this is just an extra input class, which you may have seen me use before, which just keeps track of what's been pressed and what's not pressed. It just makes things a little bit easier. And I got two render targets. So up here, I got targ as this and text as this. So whenever you see targ, it's render target 2D. And whenever you see text, it's texture 2D. And if you see vec, you can assume it's a vector too. So for targets, for render targets, we got the main target and we got our mask target. So primarily you just need the mask target and some kind of background texture that we're going to apply the heat haze onto. The hot texture is just a heat map or a texture map that we can use to do heat distortion. So we also have a mask texture, which we can use to place masks in areas where we want there to be some heat distortion. And we can use non-uniform scaling to kind of get the shapes that we want. So for example, there's this distortion texture here, and there are tutorials on the internet for making distortion textures. And then over here we have the mask texture, which I'm going to either flatten it to make it more of an oval this way, or maybe a vertical oval, depending on what kind of heat and what kind of fall off I want. In fact, you could have a variety of different types of mask textures for that purpose. You could even create one that is animated fire. And as we scroll this heat texture through it, passing these heat waves upward, it's going to wave based on the darkness and brightness of these ripples. So these will represent the waves and the heat. So belonging to the distortion, we're going to have a size, strength, and time for the distortion. We'll pass those parameters into the shader, and I'll show how those are used later. The time will just keep updating, and that'll be used to scroll that distortion heat map that we were looking at. So it'll do a wrapped scroll, essentially just changing the vertical position that it's sampling from, so it starts at a different spot. Here I just have the usual display setup stuff. You're probably familiar with all this stuff and have your own setup already, so I'm not going to go into that. Initially, I set the distortion size to decimal 042, which could be thought of as 4.2%. Strength is scaled by 4, time starts at 0, obviously. So first we load in our background texture. You'll want to make sure that in content you got your background, your distortion texture, and whatever you're using for a mask. And then we'll look at this heat effects in a second. So again, we're just loading the background texture, that heat distortion texture, and our mask. Then we load the heat effect. So as you can see here, load effects. I should show you what those are. So load effects is just returning this. And you don't have to do it this way. This is just something that I attach to some of my projects so that I can do some sandbox stuff really fast. I can just type in load effects instead of having to type this all out. Same with setting parameters. This is what is really happening when I set a texture parameter or a float parameter, for example. So I set that texture here, and I set the mask texture here. We can set them ahead of time. We don't want to set them up in the loop after because we're not changing them. So for the time parameter, I found this to be a pretty good speed. I go 0.009f, and that's for the standard 60 frames per second that it's locked into by default. If distortion time is greater than 1, we set it back to 0. So when you see main target here, this is all I'm doing. I'm setting the render target to main target. So then I'm clearing the screen here. That's not going to be essential because our texture is going to fill the entire buffer. I'm just doing the typical sprite batch begin, sprite batch end. So just this sort of sprite batch begin here. Non pre-multiplied or alpha, but it doesn't matter. Actually, you could even go opaque for the background. So I draw the full background to fill up the entire buffer. We're going to set the mask target, where we're going to put all the masking on, which will determine where the heat distortion is going to occur. So we could have a whole video game where everything's rendered on the screen. Everything that you want behind the heat is already rendered to a background that you've already drawn. So here we already did that. And now you can create a mask on a separate render target. So we're setting the render target here, and you can draw a whole bunch of them if you wanted. Anywhere where there's fire, you can just go a little bit above it and distort that mask that we looked at, that sort of black and white circle thing, and use that to tell it in the shader where it should be applying heat waves. So for this example, I'm drawing that single mask texture around the mouse's position. So wherever I put the mouse, that's where it's going to draw that mask. Just one copy of the mask in this example. And I'm scaling it so that it's the regular width, but half the height. So I'm squashing it down in sort of a football-shaped ellipse. Then we're done drawing to this render target. And down here, I'm switching to the back buffer, and I'm going to be using the effect effects hot. Let's take a look at that. I set the render target to null to make sure we're using the back buffer. And then I say begin. I'm using deferred opaque because we don't need to do any transparency stuff here. We're just rendering the whole entire finished scene. I'm using linear wrap in case I want to do background wrapping. We don't need depth. We don't need to cull anything, and then we can set the effects on the end here. In this case, we don't need to apply a world matrix, so we'll just set the effects here that we passed in, which is going to be our heat effect, which I haven't showed you yet. And what that's going to do is it's going to set those states with that effect, then it'll draw using that effect to the back buffer, and it'll draw the rendered scene. So I had the rendered scene on main target, and I'm drawing it to fit to the desktop rect. So it'll fill the entire screen. That's the destination rectangle. And when it draws it using that effect, I've already passed to it that hot mask, or I should say I've already passed to it the heat distortion texture, and it also already has a copy of the hot mask passed in. One point to clarify in case this is confusing at all, that mask target, it already knows that we want to use that texture, or that render target as a texture, and we've already created a version of that texture that's updated for this frame of the scene. So wherever the mouse is, it's going to have that mask around the mouse, so that this whole screen, basically, everything you see here is going to be black, and wherever the mouse is, it's going to have that kind of white glow around it. So in your game, you'd have a whole bunch of those little white glows wherever there's a fire or lava or something like that. It'll be slightly above that. And it already knows that we're using that texture, so we don't have to pass it in here. So if you're wondering how it gets that information, it already knows to use that. Okay, so we're also passing in the current size because that might change dynamically, and the current strength and the current time. The strength and the size might not change, so technically we could take these out of here and put them up here with these ones, keeping them down here just in case I want them to change dynamically for some sort of effect. And the time definitely changes every frame, so I'm going to pass it in. All right, so let's look at the heat effects and see how that works. This is probably the part you're more interested in. As usual, we have these defines if you want to use the OpenGL version, cross desktop, and here for if you want it to be DirectX 9 compatible. If you wanted it to be a higher version, you might say 4.0 or 5.0 for both of these. I mean, in this case, we're only using the pixel shader, so you could probably even just delete this line and this line, because we're going to continue to use the vertex shader that is normally used with sprite batch. So this first one here is our background texture in register S0. By default, I have it set for linear filtering and address wrapping. So if it goes past the edge of the texture, it's going to wrap to the other side. We also have our heat distortion texture. That's that wavy one. And I'm calling it refract map here, or distort samp. It'll be passed into whatever's in the brackets here. You'll notice I don't have a texture equals sort of thing in here. I'm just using the texture zero slot for sprite batch. So for the other ones though, for subsequent ones, you want to make sure you pass it into whatever you have between the brackets here. So we're going to use linear filtering and wrapping, definitely wrapping. And for the mask, we're setting it in register S2. This is not a refract map. This is just our full screen mask. So it's an assembly of all the masks put into one final big mask texture, which we already did. We pass that into mask text here. We're also passing in the time, the size, and the strength. So for the shader, we want to make sure these match up with our sprite batch vertex shader. So you want to make sure it's in this format for any of your pixel shaders. And I got a float 2 for distort here, and then I'm going to calculate the distortion. So normally you'd have like a text 2D sampling going on somewhere, like right here, where you'd get a color from a texture at a UV coordinate, which contains an X and Y coordinate on that texture. And those values are interpolating through the process of updating the pixel shader as it uses this. So it'd be something like this. For our distortion X, we're going to calculate it by first getting the UV coordinate here from the distortion sampler. So that's going to go into this heat distortion thing here and sample from a location. The Y value of that location, as you can see here, is getting updated by time. So as time increases, it's going to sample from further and further down inside that wavy texture. Thing to keep in mind here is this is all float 2 values, so it's like a vector 2. So the X and the Y component are worked on for each one. We scale the X and Y component by this strength value that we set, which I believe was set to 4. So it's sampling at 4 times the magnitude of whatever these values are supposed to be at this point in this portion of the texture between 0 to 1 in both U and V directions. This basically kind of just speeds up the rate that it passes through the waves. But it's mostly this time value that we're interested in. That's what scrolls it through the heat wave texture. I mean, we could even make a more intricate version of this, and then we would only multiply this by, say, 2 or even 1. So it just depends. And you can play with this number to get different results. So that's partly what this is for, just so you can mess around with it. So whatever that value is, it'll be some color value that it's fetching at that location from our distorted map or refraction map, whatever you want to call it. And we're going to get the intensity, and we can get part of the intensity from the red value, part from the green, part from the blue, depends on, doesn't really matter which ones you use. So we're going to use the red value and subtract 0.5. So normally the return value here is going to range from 0 to 1. By subtracting 0.5, it's going to range from negative 0.5 to positive 0.5. And that's the distortion. If we have some coordinate here in UV and we want to go left or right from it, we want to be able to go to negative 0.5 to positive 0.5. And we can scale the amount that we sample from. So if we want to sample from further left or even further right, we'll scale that by size here. So that's what that's doing. So this is basically just creating a vector, a distort vector, to figure out where you actually want to sample from in your actual texture, your actual background. And by sampling in that way where you're sampling from further and further and closer, depending on the heat waves, you're kind of getting a wavy effect in how long those vectors are. So what we do here is we scale the effectiveness of the heat wave. So this would make the whole screen, everything you see would be heat waves. And we don't want that. We want zero heat waving wherever it's black, and we want strong heat waving wherever it's white. And gray obviously be around 0.5 or something in between. So that's what that mask is for. So we're going to use the mask to figure out how strong it should be. So 1 times 1 is 1, so that's 100%. If this was 0.5 and it was 1, then it would be cut in half. So it just depends. You're just scaling that value. And then we can add our final vector to the UV coordinate that we were going to sample from for the background image and get that distorted version of what we should see, because it'll be getting the light from a different location because you got a heat wave passing through it. So then we can multiply that too by our color if we're colorizing it. Normally this would be white, so it'd just be 100% on all three channels. So yeah, that's all there is to the shader. It's kind of a brief, rough explanation. Hopefully you could understand it. And we'll take a look at what that looks like. I just realized I accidentally deleted this bracket here. Okay, let's try this out. So if I wanted fire up on the back of the dragon here, I could apply to the heat mask, render target, some kind of mask texture, and I could apply some mask texture over here or anywhere where there might be heat. So that way I get the fire exactly where I want it all the time. Well, the fire will be animated on its own, but the heat would kind of be sort of tickling the top parts of the fire, I guess. And you could have it dissipate differently depending on how you make the mask, essentially. And as you could see, you could even use it for... You could even modify it for, like, water ripples or something. Although, I'd prefer to use something different for that. But as you can see, if you make the rippling strong enough, like you feel this yellow right here, it's already starting to look almost like fire. So if you apply the right kind of strength to the right kind of images, you wouldn't even have to animate those images, and you'd already have something that looks a lot like fire. Well, that's all there is to that tutorial, I think. That should be good. Hopefully you found that useful, and thanks for watching.